You are a physician trained in pediatric advanced life support. You are working an overtime shift in the emergent care center when a father brings his child into the center. His father, who is with him, states the child is 10 years old. You perform the steps of basic life support and note that he is not breathing and does not have a pulse. 1. Your first action is to A. Begin CPR. B. Check for a pulse and breathing. C. Establish scene safety. D. Establish unresponsiveness. Correct answer, A. Begin CPR. You have already gone through the steps of BLS and have determined that the child needs CPR. You begin CPR and direct other team members to give oxygen via a bag mask valve device and attach a cardiac monitor. 2. High-quality CPR for this child includes all of the following except A. Compression rate 100 to 120 per minute. B. Allow full chest recoil. C. Compression to ventilation ratio of 30 to 2. D. Compression depth of greater than 1/3 of AP diameter of the chest. Correct answer, C. Compression to ventilation ratio of 30 to 2. Since there are multiple rescuers, the compression to ventilation ratio should be 15 to 2. The cardiac monitor defibrillator is in place, and you stop CPR to evaluate the rhythm. You see this rhythm on the monitor. 3. You identify this rhythm as A. PEA, B. Ventricular fibrillation, C. Asystole, D. Bradycardia. Correct answer, B. Ventricular fibrillation. Ventricular fibrillation is characterized as a chaotic rhythm without identifiable P waves or QRS complexes. Ventricular fibrillation is one of the shockable rhythms. You note that the child is in ventricular fibrillation and you prepare to shock him. 4. The appropriate shock energy for this first shock is A. 2 joules per kilogram, B. 4 joules per kilogram, C. 10 joules per kilogram, D. 20 joules per kilogram. Correct answer, A. 2 joules per kilogram. You estimate that the child weighs approximately 35 kilograms. 5. The appropriate shock energy dose for this child is A. 40 joules, B. 55 joules, C. 70 joules, D. 85 joules. Correct answer, C. 70 joules. The recommended energy dose is 2 joules per kilogram. This child weighs 35 kilograms, so the clinician multiplies 2 times 35, equaling 70. 6. Immediately following this shock, you should A. Do a quick assessment, B. Intubate the child, C. Establish vascular access, D. Perform CPR for 2 minutes. Correct answer, D. Perform CPR for 2 minutes. Following any defibrillation, the team should immediately continue CPR for 2 minutes. You order CPR to continue and ask another team member to obtain vascular access. The team member inserts a peripheral IV. Following 2 minutes of high-quality CPR, you ask the team to stop so that you can evaluate the cardiac rhythm on the monitor. You do not feel a pulse, but see this rhythm on the monitor. 7. You identify this rhythm as A. Supraventricular tachycardia. B. Pulseless ventricular tachycardia. C. Ventricular fibrillation. D. Sinus tachycardia. Correct answer, B. Pulseless ventricular tachycardia. This is a regular rhythm with a ventricular rate less than 180 beats per minute. There are no identifiable P waves before the QRS complexes, which are wide, monomorphic, and with a duration of greater than 0.09 seconds. You correctly identify this as a shockable rhythm and deliver the next shock. 8. The appropriate energy shock dose for this second defibrillation is A. 2 joules per kilogram. B. 4 joules per kilogram. C. 10 joules per kilogram. D. 20 joules per kilogram. Correct answer, B. 4 joules per kilogram. Double the initial shock dose for the second defibrillation. Any subsequent shock should be at greater than 4 joules per kilogram, up to a maximum of 10 joules per kilogram, or an adult dose. 9. Immediately following this shock, you should A. Do a quick assessment. B. Intubate the child. C. Establish vascular access. D. Perform CPR for 2 minutes. Correct answer, D. Perform CPR for 2 minutes. Following any defibrillation, the team should immediately continue CPR for 2 minutes. 10. At this time, you should also order A. Epinephrine every 3 to 5 minutes. B. Amiodarone bolus. C. Lidocaine. D. Intubation of the child. Correct answer, A. Epinephrine every 3 to 5 minutes. Epinephrine is an excellent drug to give in a cardiac arrest situation due to its alpha and beta effects. It can safely be given every 3 to 5 minutes with no maximum dose. Although you might want to consider an advanced airway, in this situation, the administration of epinephrine is the best choice. 11. The correct dose of IV epinephrine is A. 0.1 milliliters per kilogram of 1 milligram per milliliter, 1 to 1,000 concentration. B. 0.1 milliliter per kilogram of 0.1 milligram per milliliter, 1 to 10,000 concentration. C. 1 milliliter per kilogram of 1 milligram per milliliter, 1 to 1,000 concentration. D. 1 milliliter per kilogram of 0.1 milligram per milliliter, 1 to 10,000 concentration. Correct answer, B. 0.1 milliliter per kilogram of 0.1 milligram per milliliter, 1 to 10,000 concentration. The 1 to 1,000 concentration should not be used in any cardiac arrest situation. After 2 minutes of high-quality CPR and the first dose of IV epinephrine, you direct the team to stop CPR for another evaluation of the rhythm. Again, you see ventricular tachycardia on the monitor and cannot feel a pulse. You direct the team to give another shock at 8 joules per kilogram. The team delivers the shock. 12. Immediately following this shock, you should A. Do a quick assessment. B. Intubate the child. C. Give another dose of epinephrine. D. Perform CPR for 2 minutes. Correct answer, D. Perform CPR for 2 minutes. Following any defibrillation, the team should immediately continue CPR for 2 minutes. Although it might be time for another dose of epinephrine, it is more important to continue CPR. You direct the team to give a bolus of a first-line antiarrhythmic IV. At the same time, you consider the possible causes of the child's cardiac arrest. 13. You know that all of the following are reversible causes of cardiac arrest except A. Hypovolemia, B. Tension pneumothorax, C. Family history, D. Toxins. Correct answer, C. Family history. Although it is critical to obtain a good family history from the child's family, this is not a reversible cause of cardiac arrest. Family history might indicate the presence of cardiac defects or disease. Other common causes of cardiac arrest include hypoxia, hypoglycemia, hypo or hyperkalemia, hypothermia, tamponade, and thrombosis. You suspect that the child might be hypovolemic, since the father now indicates that he has had nausea and vomiting for several days. You give him a fluid challenge of 20 milliliters per kilogram as the team continues CPR. After 2 minutes of high-quality CPR, you ask the team to stop for another rhythm evaluation. You see this rhythm on the monitor. 14. You identify this rhythm as A. Ventricular tachycardia, B. Sinus tachycardia, C. Supraventricular tachycardia, D. Sinus rhythm. Correct answer, B. Sinus tachycardia. This is a regular rhythm with atrial and ventricular rates 100 to 180 per minute, with one P wave for every QRS complex. QRS complexes are less than 0.09 seconds. You feel for a pulse and note that the child now has a pulse with the cardiac rhythm. He begins to breathe spontaneously. You begin to implement the ROSC protocol and prepare to transfer him to the pediatric ICU for post-cardiac arrest care.